Well, for those of you new to the EPC, let me explain why a ruling elder is standing before you this morning. In the EPC, we rotate back and forth every other year between ruling elder and teaching elder. That is a good thing, I think. And so I stand before you this morning, sandwiched between two outstanding teaching elders, Mike Moses and Dean Weaver. And I am delighted that CCO has been leading us. They've been our transition this week, our prayers. I'm a product of a college ministry. I would not be here if it wasn't for Seekers, started by Homer and Isabel Goddard. There are actually Seekers in our midst this morning, believe it or not. It was the CCO of the West Coast. And so I was trained up as a layperson to go into the workplace and share the gospel. C.S. Lewis began his last sermon with these words: "When a layman preaches a sermon, he is most likely to be useful or even interesting." I can't do that in an English accent. I wish I could. "If he starts exactly from where he is himself, not so much presuming to instruct as comparing notes." Now, I am no C.S. Lewis. I am no JFK either. But I think his layman's approach is good. So I look forward to comparing notes with you this morning on the theme of this General Assembly. I have chosen to use the first few verses of Matthew 7 as my text. You're probably wondering why. You will soon know. The reason I chose it is because I'm starting from exactly where I am myself, just as C.S. Lewis told me I should do. Now, I'm aware that I'm speaking to a room full of students and teachers of the Word, and that you have all taught and preached and compared notes on these same verses. So let's start by asking the Holy Spirit to shed a new light on this scripture with us this morning. Would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are honored to be called your people, to call you our God. Lead us this morning as we open your word together. Holy Spirit, fall afresh on us. Give us new insight into your word. May I move into the background and may you move into the foreground. God, we give you all the honor and blessing and glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'll be reading from the words of Jesus from Matthew 7, verses 1 through 5. We used to say, grab your Bibles. Now we say, pull your iPhones and follow along with me on this scripture. "Judge not that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when there is the log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." This is the word of the Lord. So as an introduction to our theme of generation to generation, we're going to explore three messages, three themes from this passage of Scripture. First, this passage is aimed at us. Jesus is talking to us. Yes, the Pharisees needed to hear this, but so do we. I need to hear this. Second, unfair or unloving judgment is always wrong. Third, always watch out for the mustard. Now, I do understand parallel structure, and that's thrown in there. I'm a layperson, so I can throw that in there. Mike will give me some coaching later. So, let's walk briefly through these verses. Verse 1. "Judge not that you be not judged." The word "judge" here cannot mean discerning right from wrong, right? It cannot mean that we are not to judge rightly, because we are told to do that. 1 Corinthians 5:5, Philippians 3:2, Galatians 6:1, Hebrews 3:13, etc. Commentators suggest, and I believe them because I'm a layman, that this refers to a judgmental attitude, a critical spirit. And this is the key, we're going to talk about this again, the absence of love. The second half of that verse, that you be not judged. When we judge others from a position of superiority or without love, they will judge us. And more importantly, God will judge us. Now, Jesus, in chapter 6, right after the Sermon on the Mount, had just given a parallel. Let's read it together. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Do you see the parallel there to the verses that we're reading? Verse 2, for with the judgment you pronounce, you'll be judged. This first part is a restatement from chapter 6. The absence of love will result in our being judged by God, whether we're refusing to forgive someone or whether we have a judgmental heart. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. This is the same message stated in a different way. Fellow ruling elders, what does it mean when we see the same message stated in a different way? It means it's important. Pay attention. Thank you. This is a common Jewish proverb stemming from grain contracts. This is my favorite part of this scripture. My least favorite part is the word hypocrites. We'll get to that in a moment. A measure was a weight or a scoop that you used to measure goods purchased or goods sold. It needed to be true. If you were supposed to give a peck, you wanted the scoop to measure an accurate peck. In the proverb, which is in Mark 4:24, it signifies the way we treat others. Here it means the standard by which we judge others. How would you feel if someone used an unfair peck measure to measure you? That's what we're supposed to get. Verse 3, why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Now notice the word brother. That is so that we, the community of believers, you and I, know that he's talking to us. We're tempted to think it's only the Pharisees. They were a judgmental lot. He uses the word brothers. This is for us. Now, a speck, my senior pastor, Tommy Allen, uses these beautiful wood planes to build stuff by hand. A speck would be chaff that Tommy would take off of a piece of wood that could get in your eye. A log would be a beam that was used in holding up a roof or in a wall. Speck versus log, this is rabbinic hyperbole, layman's translation. Why do we see a tiny flaw in another when we conveniently ignore the giant flaw in ourselves? Verse 4, or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when there is a log in your own eye? Now this looks like a repeat of verse 3, it's not. In verse 3, we're noticing the speck in our eye, and this one, we're offering to get it out. Verse 5, this is the climax. You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. The hypocrisy is that we pretend to have no faults while looking down on someone else and criticizing them and judging them. Now, Jesus puts extra mustard on this. I was a baseball player. When the catcher would come out to the mound, I was a pitcher, he would say, Scott, let's put a little extra mustard on this next fastball. This is extra mustard. Jesus is throwing us a fastball high and inside here. You hypocrite. When we fuss over small things in others and pay no attention to the great matters of our own heart, our Savior says we are hypocrites. Now, this has been a quick walkthrough because I'm a layman. I'm eager to get to application. So let me summarize. First, this passage is aimed at us, brothers and sisters. Jesus is certainly including the Pharisees here. They were a judgmental lot. and often so am I. One commentator offers this insight onto who is being addressed, and this stings me, and I hope it stings you just a little. It is common for those that are the most sinful themselves and the least sensible of it, ouch, to be the most forward and free in judging and censoring others. Second, unfair and unloving judgment is always wrong. It is never okay to be a hypocrite. Again, he's not speaking against fair judging, honest judging. He is telling us to deal with our own huge issues before we attempt to help with another person's issue. And then my favorite, the mustard. The word hypocrite is a clear signal. We need to be watchful. I need to be watchful. Be mindful of not thinking and acting like a hypocrite. Hypocrisy is incredibly destructive to our Christian walk, to our witness, and to the church. Now let's apply God's word to our lives. I'll start with my own life. This year's moderator has been one of intense learning for me. It has been so good to attend church all over the EPC. It's been good for my soul. I'm impressed with you as ruling and teaching elders, serving God's church. In the background, God has been working on me, starting in my devotional life, to convict me that I am often unfairly judgmental of others. I was trained to do that. I'm a technical person, a geek. Is that the right term from yesterday? I am proudly a geek. And we are trained to find problems and fix them before they can rear their ugly heads. I have taken that into my personality, and too often I look around me and see problems that need to be fixed. That is hypocritical. I've also been reading on generations. I've been praying about what I should say this morning for a year. God brought those two things together. I hope I can show you how that happened. I was surprised to find out that I don't understand the generation that came before me as well as I thought I did, and I certainly don't understand my kids' generation as well as I need to. I discovered something else, the reason I chose Matthew 7. I am often unfairly judgmental of generations other than my own. Let me give you a brief background on generations, then we'll come back and put this all together. I'll start by naming the generations. Kirk mentioned three of them the other day. I'm going to add builders to the top, those of us that are born before 1945, baby boomers. I'm a baby boomer. That's probably a baby boomer phone that's ringing right now. Because millennials know to put their phones on mute before they come into the service. Baby boomers, born between 46 and 64, Gen X. That was a horrible title. And Gen Xers tried to get rid of it, but we couldn't come up with anything better. So forgive me, Gen Xers. Born between 65 and 80. Millennials, born between 81 and 2001. Wasn't that delightful to see the millennials up here? I was really blessed by that. And the next generation, which I put in parentheses, Gen Z. They're going to probably try to avoid Gen Z as well. I don't know if they'll be successful. Hayden Shaw, in his book, Generational IQ, an excellent book, by the way, written for the church, says that the historical events during a generation's childhood years shape their values, worldview, and definition of success. Now, we are the leaders of the church. We know that it's the gospel that shapes our values, our worldview, and our definition of success, right? But to a lesser extent, so does the generation that we're born into. Shaw goes on to point out, often we miss opportunities to connect with others because our assumptions are based on our own generation's experiences and culture. So there's been some big shifts. I'm going to mention three of them because I think it's important, and we'll come back to Matthew 7, over the last five generations. So these shifts have happened since the builders were born. First, people live longer. This is simple math. I'm a mathematician. In the year 1900, the average life expectancy was 47 years. Today, that's middle age. One of you told me, that's not middle age, that's the new 30. So let's even say there isn't a middle age. Because we live longer, we now have five generations in our families, our communities, and our churches. That's complex. Second shift, and we talked about this yesterday with David Kinneman, there's been a dramatic change in the quantity, quality, speed, and availability of information. Prior to the baby boomer generation, only those in charge had access to information. Builders, do you remember how good it was to be the head of a family and be the only one that had information? Today, anyone with a smartphone can find the answer to any question. It might not be the right answer. I'll tell you, as a technology leader, Wikipedia scares me, especially when you ask questions of faith and theology. Third, the wait your turn approach does not work as well as it used to. Remember that, parents? Wait your turn. Well, the expectations of the younger generation, which is an educated consumer generation, have changed, and so they may choose to wait their turn to take over the family business, the family vocation, the family farm, but they're not limited to that. So what's happening is the distance between generations, the gap is getting bigger. And these three reasons, I just pulled three out of my studies. There are generational differences in how we communicate. Our dress code, baby boomers, I'm wearing fancy shoes. I'm going to take them off as soon as communion is over. And our decision making, among others. I want to give you one example of the differences between generations, and this is general. It's not specific. There are exceptions. When it comes to decision making, builders let the boss decide. That's hierarchical. That's the way our military is mostly structured, not totally now. Baby boomers, what do you think I'm going to say about us? Man, this one nails me. We create a complex decision-making process where everyone has a vote, and in the end, the boss says, okay, I've heard everything, here's how we're going. I'm embarrassed by how correct that is. Gen Xers have a new process. It's a good process. Let the most savvy person on the topic make the call. That was very different than baby boomers. That's not wrong. That's just as valid as my process. And our millennials, I love our millennials. They work through the options and decide as a team. Do you see the difference in our one example between the four generations? Can you see that in your churches? I can. One aha on millennials. Remember I said I don't understand my kids' generation as well as I wish I did. They want meaning, authentic relationships, and teams. This is a big one. They don't get easily excited about committees. Maybe I shouldn't have shared that at General Assembly. Now, here's the generational challenge for all of us. I'm starting to go back to Matthew 7. We use stereotypes when we speak of other generations, stereotypes that we would never think of using of other people groups. Often, we unfairly judge other generations. This happens in the workplace, that's my mission field, and it happens at church. It should not be happening at church. We judge other generations for being, listen to this list. And by the way, this is a multi-generational list. We judge other generations for being too serious, too lazy, too rigid, too lax, not authentic, too casual, not casual enough, too whiny, too connected, or not connected enough. The list goes on. Do any of these judgments sound familiar to you? Let me add some mustard. They are hypocritical. To make those judgments, we must think we're in some place where we can be judging a different generation to make those comments. So, how do we deal with the generational gap in the church? How do we get past negative stereotypes, generational biases, judgments, and work together? How do we pass the baton to a generation which is very different than ours? I say we take our inspiration from the early church, from the Great Commission. One of my mentors, Dr. Paul Pearson, wrote an outstanding book on Acts called Themes from Acts. By the way, Mary and I were with Paul and Rosemary last month. It's now in Arabic, just translated into Arabic. It was created from sermons that he gave when Mary and I were in college. Remember the Seekers College group? It's a very influential time in our lives. I reread it this year as part of my devotion, and it shed new light on the challenges of the early church, and it actually gave me a framework for thinking about generations. Describing the book of Acts, Paul wrote a summary statement that addresses the challenges. He uses the word barriers. I like that. That the early church faced. Listen to this missional statement for the church. God has a purpose for his people within history and a strategy for them to follow. His strategy, demonstrated frequently in the book, is that men and women called by the Holy Spirit and supported by the church would cross every kind of barrier, geographical, cultural, linguistic, and religious, which prevents others from hearing the good news, going to them and inviting them to discipleship. I like that picture. Think about the early church crossing barriers as they witnessed martyr to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. We heard that theme at the dinner on Tuesday night. Dean got teary yesterday. I got teary last year when he got to the last question for our missionaries, because the word martyrs, witness, is the word martyr. The early church went to them with the gospel. They lived out the great commission. They went to the hard places. We've talked about that several times this week. And they faced the barrier of generation as well. They had to, didn't they? They had to witness not only to people of their own generation, but to people in the generation before them and the generation after them. Remember the stir when Jesus called the little children to himself and against the disciples' objections. That was a cross-generational moment, a teaching moment meant for us. And at some point, the disciples had to hand the baton to the next generation of leaders. How did they do? We are here 100 generations later. I'd say they figured it out. I'd like to end with a suggestion. In light of Matthew 7 and the Great Commission, on how the church might address the opportunity, the blessing of generations, I'll start by drawing a parallel. There's a difference between going into another culture as a tourist. We've all done it. Cruise ship, hop on, hop off. Try the local food, buy a local gift. And going into another culture with an intent to really learn about that culture, immersion, what our world outreach missionaries do, what we should be doing in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. If we're serious about understanding another culture, we go to them. And we arrive with a desire to ask questions and an orientation towards listening. We listen empathically, with empathy, seeking to understand rather than seeking to be understood. And that is how I propose we enter into community with other generations. We cannot understand other generations unless we ask questions. We need to go to them. I repeat, We need to go to them. To sit down face to face and understand their concerns, their joys, and their life issues, we need to listen first and talk second. We need to guard against judging unfairly. We cannot sit down with a log in our own eye or bring an unfair peck measure to the table. In summary, I am excited for the EPC family of congregations and missionaries to cross every barrier together. Geographical, cultural, linguistic, religious, and generational, which prevents others from hearing the good news. For we are ordinary people called and empowered by the Holy Spirit to leap, to knock down extraordinary barriers for the sake of the kingdom. Would you pray with me?